Hello everyone and welcome back. Thanks for joining me, and if you're new here, hi, hello, welcome. My name is Zoe and this is my channel Ms. Manga, where I talk usually about manga, but today we're mixing things up and we're talking about some more K-dramas. I actually have watched a couple so far this year and I just kind of wanted to talk about them, you know, do a little something different again on my channel. So I hope you stay tuned and enjoy. I want to apologize if you hear any mowing in the background because it's that time of year again and I got to film and people got to mow. So I don't know if you can hear it. I can hear it and it's slightly annoying, but the show must go on. And lastly, I also got a new phone and that's what I'm filming on. And so I hope that the picture quality looks a little nicer. That was part of the reason I wanted a new phone, because cameras keep getting better every phone and I hadn't gotten one in a couple of years. And also because I needed one because it was bugging out on me a little bit. So yeah, I hope this is a little bit of a sharper image for you all. And without further ado, let's get talking about some K-dramas. So far this year, I have started watching 3 K-dramas, but I only finished 2. I tend to be very picky when it comes to what K-dramas I can finish. I don't know why. There are a decent amount of them I've dropped. If you want a video about the ones that I couldn't make it all the way through and why, you know, comment below, I guess. I've been thinking of doing ones that are like popular series that I either dropped or just didn't enjoy. And the other reason is probably because I hate to say I have to, so I will say I really prefer to watch foreign media in their original language. So that means I watch sub, and that means I can't take my eyes off the screen for a minute, or I might freaking not understand what's going on because I don't speak Korean, obviously, or any other language. I know a lot of people watch it dubbed. I just can't, especially live action. It really bugs me when the lips aren't syncing. Netflix actually made me watch something recently that was dubbed, and it was done really well, by the way, because I didn't notice until a couple episodes in. So I will say their dubbing game isn't bad by any means, but once I noticed, it was bothering me, and I went and it was like, oh my god, I was watching this in dubbed. And it was I'll put what it was, but it didn't seem right off the bat that it might have been something dubbed, so to me it didn't really register. But then I kept thinking throughout the episode, like 2 or 3 episodes I watched, I'm like, is that what they said? It didn't look like that's the way their mouths moved. And it wasn't, because some of them are speaking English but some of them are not. So yeah, that was an interesting series, by the way. Just random side note there. Sorry. But yeah, I like to watch things subbed, and so it really has to grab me. Grab my attention, I have to be in the right mood, I have to just want to sit down, relax, and enjoy a subtitled feature. And you know, them being like 45-ish minutes long, 16 episodes usually, sometimes more, it's a commitment. So yeah, I'll start with saying the one I started and haven't finished yet was Backstreet Rookie. I really was thinking this was gonna be my cup of tea. It's G has a thing for him and he's kind of thinking she's up to something. He doesn't trust her. And so I kind of thought that that would be kind of an interesting dynamic, but I got 2 episodes deep and it was not grabbing me. So that leads me to the first K-drama I started that I actually did complete, Hometown Cha-Cha-Cha. I loved the crap out of this one. It made me smile like almost the whole time I was watching it, except for like when sadder moments obviously were happening. But like, I just thought it was so charming and sweet and wholesome. So yeah, anyway, let's start with this. The characters. Again, I really, really apologize for my terrible, terrible mispronouncing of Korean names. I know I'm terrible at it. I can listen to it for 16 episodes and it's still just, I don't know. I'm terrible. I'm so sorry. I apologize. But anyway, we got Yoon Hee-jin, and our male protagonist is Hong Doo-sik. I don't know again, I'm so sorry. Anyway, after a conflict with her boss, dentist Yoon Hee-jin escapes the city to a seaside village where she had vacationed as a young girl. When she learns the village is without a dentist, she decides to set up her practice there permanently. But the former city dweller's stiff and guarded demeanor almost immediately rubs the locals the wrong way. In steps the free-spirited jack-of-all-trades Hong Doo-sik to help her learn to navigate life in a small village, albeit they don't hit it off well at first either. And that's the synopsis, obviously. And it's really just a cute premise. Both kind of damaged characters, they've been through a decent amount. Like it talks about Yoon Hee-jin is pretty guarded and cold at first when we meet her, and she's also a city girl, so this like slow-paced small town life is disarming to her, and people just like wanting to talk to her about like their whole entire lives, which I get that a lot. I come from a small town, I get that, like they just talk to you for like, it seems like they will never leave you alone, and you're just like, I do not need to hear your whole backstory. But she's very like callous and cold to these townsfolk at first. But at the same time, she can be very warm-hearted and caring, as Hong Doo-sik notices in the very beginning when he kind of spots her helping some young kids. So there's obviously layers to her personality, and she just has a very cold demeanor, which I liked, and he even has a kind of cold demeanor towards her, where he is the most lovely, helpful, kind, and like cheerful man towards everyone in the village, and this is like his hometown that he's returned to, so he knows them all since childhood, and so he's very friendly and open with them, but then he's very kind of cold and like guarded towards her. So their dynamic is really great, and I loved it off the bat. The larger cast of townspeople are actually quite endearing. Like, I really got to like all of them. Like I said, they're a bit annoying in the beginning, and I totally can sympathize with Yoon Hee-jin because they're like a little too much. But you get to learn more about them and really like connect with them through the story as she does. So you get to really like, I mean, I really liked them. The larger cast was great and funny and charming and just added that small town charm to the story. And then of course the main characters themselves have a real likability to them and a really cute relationship as it like, you know, kind of moves into stiff, awkward strangers, then friendly. He obviously is like keeping tabs on her, keeping his eye on her, and then she also kind of notices him in a different way. And then, you know, moving on up to more than just friends, maybe. And I really liked how that played out. I'd say like my only critique is when they were like actually in a relationship, they were a little bit of those couples that I can't stand that are just, and I say this as like probably I am like this in a relationship because I can get very much like, ah, I'm so into you. But yeah, they were just like so mushy and all over each other, and it was just kind of like, but it's only a short time and it's cute even though it's like a little much. I think it's sweet. It's a bit fast-paced, their relationship, I think, but I still enjoyed it even though, you know, it's a bit unrealistic perhaps, but it's a K-drama, you know, what do you expect? And yeah, it was just sweet, refreshing, wholesome series, and I would I gave it a 9 out of 10, which is pretty high for me. Like, it's a possible rewatching one. But yeah, this one was really solid and I just really liked it. So yeah. So our second K-drama is our beloved Summer. It gave me the like cute rom-com aspect to it. And I especially loved when they were in high school, which is unusual for me because I tend to only like K-dramas that are, and like a lot of romances at this point in my life, that are older. And this one's split between their time in high school and their time as an adult, reconnecting after high school. But yeah, so like, let me just get into the characters and the synopsis. So we have Choi Woon, sorry again about the pronunciations, and Cook Yoon Soo, and they are our protagonists in this coming of age romantic comedy about ex-lovers who broke up with a promise to never meet again. But as luck would have it, the documentary they filmed 10 years ago in high school went viral, and they are now forced to face the cameras together once again. The series depicts their complicated feelings and growth. I really like the concept for this one, although I kind of said in the beginning, I really would like more of them in high school. Their banter and their bickering and their just their relationship in high school is so charming to me. And I really like it. It's kind of your classic enemies to lovers, but I don't think they ever really hated each other. They just didn't get each other, and then they slowly got feelings for each other. But I also really, really like when they're adults and you can see how much they've matured from their on and off again relationship that, you know, it wasn't the healthiest. You know, they would break up and get back together. And when they're adults, they obviously start at like the lowest point. Like, there's a lot of hurt and resentment from Choi Woon, who was the one who was broken up with, and he literally, when she ends up knocking at his door, because unfortunately she ends up having to ask him a favor in the present timeline, he literally closes the door in her face, goes back, gets a spray bottle of water, and like sprays her. And then he ends up getting some salt and throwing it at her because she's a demon. Like, and he practiced this. He is childish. He is childish. But and then she's just standing there like, what the fuck? Why did I have to come here and deal with this again? But starting from that very, like, obviously bad point, they really, like, start to address the things that went wrong in their past relationship. Sweet to see how much growth after the whole water and salt incident. But they do experience a lot of growth within the show, individually, and then together as kind of a second chance at the same love type of story, which is interesting because I don't know if I can think of another one off the top of my head. There's probably others, but it was a different kind of theme, because usually you have a second chance at love story, or you might have like childhood friends that never, or like people that never quite got together and then they meet up later in life and they get together. But you don't usually find one that dated for long term when they were younger, had a bad breakup, then because of situations, aka it's a K-drama, they end up back in each other's life and then feelings reemerge. And so it's a second chance at the same love, which I think is really interesting and funny and complicated. But yeah, I really enjoyed it. I thought it was done well. It's a simple story, but I found it really charming. And obviously, like, that's because I really ended up loving the characters. I thought some of the characters were a bit, I don't wanna say unnecessary, but like, we had this character who was, I don't remember her name in the story, and it was like just two letters. But she was like supposed to be this like famous idol, and her story was really interesting, like how, like what she was personally going through, but like her being interested in Choi Woong, but yet not really being an ever a tangible obstacle for Choi Woong and Cook Yoon Soo, was weird, but I didn't hate it at the same time. You know, usually when you have that second female or male lead, it's because it's to cause tension between our, you know, protagonists and their relationship, but yet she never really does. Just complicated feelings about the side characters. They all kind of felt strange and almost unnecessary. Like, if you took them away, it really wouldn't have changed the story. It took away the friend who ended up filming them. Someone else could have just filmed them. Like, honestly, any of the minor characters I felt could have been easily replaceable or non-existent. So it just, to me, was weird. Whereas Hometown Cha-Cha-Cha, I really felt like I loved a lot of the minor characters and they all felt distinctly important to the story, even if they didn't make huge impacts or like create huge waves with the characters. Does that make sense? I don't know if I'm explaining that well, but like, yeah, the side characters just felt a little weak in this one, like underdeveloped maybe or something. They all had these like almost cliche type relationships or roles to play in the story, but yet then the cliches were kind of subverted and didn't really play out like one might expect, which I liked. It's complicated. That being said, I really enjoyed Our Beloved Summer. I found it cute and charming and a funny watch, and yeah, I also gave it a 9 out of 10. I think if I'm like being honest with myself, it'd be more of an 8, 8.5. But you know, I just, what can I say? I was charmed by them. I'd probably be more apt to watch Hometown Cha-Cha-Cha again before I watch them, but I think Our Beloved Summer, when their relationship really gets going, it didn't make me feel this, give me that, oh god, they're so cheesy feel that Hometown Cha-Cha-Cha did. So there's a plus for Our Beloved Summer. I definitely liked how they were later on. Really enjoy the relationships and the dynamics between both pairs of the leads in these two K-dramas, and I think that's what really made me be invested in the series and stay for the whole show and keep watching with my limited attention span. It was just like a nice, they were both like just nice relaxing shows that I could just kind of like fall into. I would really recommend both of them. I think they're super solid and enjoyable. If you feel like either of those type of romances, then you know where to find them. So yeah, that's it. That's the end. Those are the two K-dramas I've watched so far this year, and I really enjoyed both of them. Honestly, when I actually finish an entire K-drama, I will like 99% of the time be like, I really liked it. Because I mean, if I don't lose interest in it, then obviously I really liked it. And I also watched Alice in Borderland season 2. I have talked about Alice in Borderland so much, but just in case you somehow missed it, Alice in Borderland is a survival game-esque battle royales type Japanese drama live action series. It is also available on Netflix, and I seriously, seriously recommend it. I was really satisfied with the ending. I'm not gonna go into detail because it would be super spoilery to talk about that one. But yeah, the manga is also ongoing, being published in the United States. It is complete in Japan, but I have not like gone online to try and like read ahead. I'm just like reading as the volumes are published, and I feel that there is enough change, enough differences in the manga and the live action series so far that I've been really enjoying both of them. And yeah, now that the live action one is finished, I am very much curious as to see how the ending compares, if anything's different with the manga. But yeah, overall I was happy. I was satisfied with the ending. Sometimes those survival type games are just kind of like okay, and then that was the reason. And I kind of feel like that I'm kind of left with a lot more questions, and I'm kind of like, yeah, just that didn't feel fulfilling. But for the most part with this one, I was like, that's how it, okay. And it all kind of came together and I felt good about it. If you have watched it and want to leave your non-spoilery comments, whether you really liked the ending or maybe you didn't like the ending, let me know. I'd like to hear what other people thought about it. If you have any recommendations for other K-dramas or series you think I might like based off of, you know, what I've talked about and what I've enjoyed so far, let me know in the comments below. I'd always love more K-drama recommendations because there's so many out there and I'm very picky about it, but I can't pinpoint. If I could figure out like what it is, like the equation that makes me want to watch a series all the way to the end, then I wouldn't start so many series that I like kind of lose interest in. Not saying I won't try and go back and get further with Backstreet Rookie and maybe I'll really fall into it, but a lot of times I've noticed when I've lost interest early on, even if I push myself to keep going, it never really, you know, connects with me, and it ends up just kind of like just trying to push myself through it because I started it, so I should. But you never know. So yeah, of course, if you like this video, please like the video. And if you haven't already, please subscribe. It would mean so much to me. And you can see this face every Monday for Manga Mondays. And then sometimes you get an extra little bonus video during the week. Lucky you. Saying it like it's a treat for you or something. But yeah. It would mean a lot if you subscribed and joined the manga family. We sometimes talk about K-dramas or other things of interest to me. And yeah, with that, I hope to see you next time. Bye!